We are doing almost nothing with the data that we collect from the BMS. In today's video, I'm going to prove to you the complete lack of innovation in the BMS industry, the building management system industry, in the past 20 years. And to do that, I'm not going to try and impress you with some super complicated example. I'm going to choose two of the most basic points that we monitor in a chilled system and show you just what we can achieve, just what we can do with two points that probably every single BMS in the world monitors from the chilled system. Because what we're generally doing right now is we do all the hard work, these big construction projects. We deliver these big, nasty construction projects with limited materials, limited resources, not enough money, and not enough time. We take the pain of a big construction project or big upgrade projects, and what we do is we collect all this raw data, all these inputs and outputs. We collect the raw data, and then we do almost nothing with the visualization of that data. What we do is we present that raw data to the cloud, and we say to our competing industries, cloud technology companies, take our raw data, process it, visualize it in an engaging way, and create insights. Impress our customers, make us look stupid. That is what we've been doing for the past 20 years. All right, so as I said, let's put to one side anything too complicated. So let's forget about magnetic flow meters, kilowatts of refrigerant calculations, coefficient of performance calculations, electric meters. Put that to one side. What would be more simple than that, right? If we're monitoring, you know, temperature or pressure, like what's even more simple than that? The most simple thing is the BMS monitoring the run status and the fault status from the chiller. Normally even a low-level connection. Don't even need a high-level interface to it. Every BMS must monitor that surely. So an example one we're gonna talk through now is this analysis of the chiller run status monitoring. So what we normally do is we monitor the run status and we map it onto a graphic. And if you happen to be looking at the graphic live, logged into the BMS, you would see the chiller run status go on, off through the day. You'd see that. And we'd also probably trend that point, never to be looked at again. So that's what we do. We get the information, we monitor the run status, and we just visualize it. We just visualize it. We don't do any analysis of that point. This is what we could do. And this is so basic. All we do is we count the number of times the run status goes on off. 1, 2, 3, 4. We just count it. A never-ending totalization of the run status. For 5 years, how many times it starts stop? And then we take that run status accumulation and we have a graph, January, February, March through to December, and we show on their little bar chart how many times the chiller 1, 2, and 3 start stop in January, February, March. That's what we do that. And then it creates an insight because, oh, chiller 1 is starting and stopping 10 times more than chiller 2 and 3 combined. Why is that? Why is chiller 1 starting and stopping so much? Because chiller 1 will probably need to be replaced 5 years before chiller 2 and 3 because we don't have equal wear and tear on our chillers. Chillers don't like stopping and stopping, starting and stopping all day long. So what happens is we generate this insight and then we have a meeting. So there's the BMS service technician, the chiller service technician, and the customer, the facility manager, the building engineer. We have a meeting and we say to the chiller tech, hey, why is the chiller starting and stopping so much? Why is chiller 1 starting and stopping so much? And the chiller tech says, well, it's a low load condition. There's not enough load in the field to keep the chiller running. It starts, it smashes the load as fast as it can because chillers like to be heroes. Chillers like to start up and pull that temperature down to 6 degrees Celsius as fast as they can and try to impress people. That's what chillers like doing. There's just not enough load in the field. And then the building engineer says to the BMS service technician, is there anything we can do about this in the controls? And the service technician says, yes, we can. What we could do is this. In a low load condition, when the chiller turns off, we can disable the chiller, keep it off, but keep the pump running. We can dissipate all that chilled water that's in the pipework. We can dissipate it like a big battery storage, dissipate the water, and we'll watch the return water temperature. And as the return water temperature starts increasing, you know, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 degrees Celsius, we might wait a bit longer than usual because there's not much load. And when it gets to about, say, 14 degrees Celsius return water temperature, we then bring the chiller back on again. However, we raise the chiller supply water temperature set point from 6 degrees Celsius to 10 degrees Celsius. It's a low load condition. We don't need 6 degrees Celsius. 10 might be fine for what the load is. So the idea here is we hold the chiller off for longer as we purposely dissipate that chill water that's been stored in the system. And then when we do bring it back on again, we bring it back on to 10 degrees Celsius and we try and keep it on for longer. I think that the chiller, when it comes, starts back up again, it sees, okay, my set point's 10, not 6. It might just start a bit slower. Not all compressors go hard to get it down to 6. The thought here is that we're modifying the control system to introduce this low load control mode to keep the chiller on for longer and off for longer. That's what we're doing. And the point here is, we monitored the raw data, the chiller run status. We visualized it like we do now, but we try to analyze or diagnose the information that we're collecting to create an insight. The insight creates discussion with our customer and the other service contractors. And the discussion leads to a mini project to improve the low load control strategy. Like, that's super important because customers want partners. Customers want partners to analyze their building and make suggestions and work with them. It's exciting to improve things. Building owners do not want BMS service technicians walking around looking for broken things for $100,000 a year maintenance cost. And as a sort of a side discussion, not quite relevant to this discussion, this low load mode, I actually call it buffer tank mode, because what was happening in Australia was some of our really smart tier one mechanical contractors, they keep value engineering out the low load chiller and replacing it with a big fat 10,000 liter buffer tank. And this helps them to win jobs because the other tendering mechanical contractors, the fools, they tender specification compliant. Who would have thought? So I remember like in around about 2012, when I worked for BMS companies, I was getting sick to death of this problem where these big high load chillers were running in low load conditions. So on that particular job, I just couldn't get this worked out. I had a workshop with the chiller manufacturer. I said, look at this trend, this big chiller. I don't have a low load chiller. It was specified, we never got it. It's on, off, on, off, on, off, on, off, on, off all day long. What do we do? And we had a workshop, me and the chiller manufacturer, and they said, well, why don't you hold us off for a bit longer, wait for the return to increase, bring us back on again, raise our temperature. And we did that. So I call this buffer tank mode, actually, in my projects, because, you know, we're staging down to this buffer tank because the low load chiller got value engineered out. Example number two, chiller fault. What do we normally do? We monitor the chiller fault status and we map it on a graphic. If the chiller's in fault, that point goes from normal to alarm, probably goes red. We take that alarm, the date and time, and we bury it in an alarm register with 500 other unacknowledged alarms. And when we do acknowledge it and it's cleared, it disappears. Now, I'm sure you could probably somehow run a report to find previously acknowledged alarms, but it's not obvious. Either way, when you acknowledge it and the chiller's normal, that information is gone. Unless you go through the trend for 12 months, which is completely impractical. So what we should do is, just like the previous example, we count how many times the chiller's in fault. Fault, normal, fault, we count that. A never-ending totalization, 10 years of totalizing it, and then you can run your little dashboard report thing to break it down to yearly, monthly, weekly, whatever it is. So maybe chiller one was in fault last year 50 times for a total of 300 hours. That's important, 300 hours. So we count how many times it goes from fault to normal, and then every time it's in fault, we start a timer and we totalize for how long it's in fault. So it's in fault, 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, normal. 3 months later, it's in fault, 4 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours, 7 hours, normal. We totalize for how long it's in fault. At the end of the year, we run a report. It says that chiller one was in fault 50 times last year for a total of 300 hours. What? Chiller 1 is our most energy efficient chiller. It wasn't available for 300 hours. That's devastating. We need a meeting. Chiller Tech, BMS Tech owner. Chiller Tech, why is Chiller 1 going into fault 50 times a year? Well, that's because I went through the chiller control panel, looked at my log file. It looks like it's tripping on low water flow through the evaporator. BMS Tech, can we do anything about that? Well, yes, we actually modulate the bypass control valve to maintain the minimum flow through the evaporator. The chiller should never ever trip on low flow. It shouldn't happen. Our bypass control isn't quite working very well. Let me come back to site next week. I'll tune that bypass control valve and work out why it's tripping. I can fix that. That is gold information. That is gold information. That's how many times was it in fault and for how long was it in fault? The insight creates a discussion. We change something. We improve something. We make the BMS and the whole building better. Building owners want partners. They want their contractors, their service providers to behave like partners and not to walk around for $100,000 a year looking for broken things to then create fee proposals to try and upsell and increase their revenue. That's not what they want. They want someone to work with them, to understand their building, to analyze their building, not just to visualize information. Listen, our performance in the past 20 years, it's embarrassing. The building management system industry, the building automation system industry, we have not evolved very much in the past 20 years. So I've been reading this book for a couple of months. I'm a slow reader and I fall asleep sometimes. I want to read you an extract from this book which completely blew my mind. I was lying on the couch and I was reading this thing. I read this and I was like, oh my God, that's exactly what's happening in the BMS industry. In the mid-1990s, Harvard Business School professor Clayton Christensen received a call from Andy Grove, the CEO and chairman of Intel. Grove had encountered Christensen's research on disruptive innovation and asked him to fly out to California to discuss the theory's implications for Intel. On arrival, Christensen walked through the basics of disruption. This is what he said. Entrenched companies are often unexpectedly dethroned by startups that begin with cheap offerings at the low end of the market, but then, over time, improve their cheap products just enough to begin to steal high-end market share. I'm going to reword that slightly for our industry. Entrenched industries are often unexpectedly dethroned by startups that begin with a single simple solution, but then over time improve their single solution just enough to begin to steal high-end market share. And that, my friends, is exactly what's been happening the last 10 years and definitely the last 5 years. BMS companies, we gave away energy management systems. Here, cloud technology companies, have a go at that. You'll love it. That evolved into us giving away building analytics. And these cloud technology companies, they work very hard to take our raw data and visualize it in a way that generates insights and engagement with their customer to impress their customer. Why don't we just do that? We produce all the infrastructure, the networks, the network controllers, the field controllers, the control strategies, graphics, alarms, trends, reports. We service the thing, we install the thing, we upgrade the, we do all the infrastructure and we stop short of providing a valuable, useful, insightful product. For the past 3 or 4 months, I've been writing up an advanced chiller management system visualization and analysis manual. It's almost 50 pages. If you had to read that document and just build, 20% of it, just build 20% of what I've written up there, you'd have a very good chiller management system visualization package, probably better than any BMS system. If you had to build half, just half of what I've written out there, you would have, in my opinion, a best-in-class chiller management system visualization package. Better than any BMS system, better than any chiller manufacturer, better than any cloud-hosted technology company. If that is something that interests you, please see down below in the YouTube description box a link to our online shop. You are one click away from reading that document. Thank you, and I will see you in the next one.